Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's such a joy to be here this morning. I want to thank PIC, Pastor Ku, and also for Pastor Ho, and the missions chair, Dr. Chan, Dr. Chua, for inviting me to come to take this morning's message. This is a picture of my family. They were here this morning, but they need to rush back to their own church. My eldest son, Lemuel, is 21, and Lisbeth, she's 17, Lazary, 13. Last but not the least, Latricia, she's 10. So when you have many children, sometimes when I pause, when I need to remember their age, why? Because every year their age changes. So need to remember, so I don't say the wrong age. My brothers and sisters, do you remember any embarrassing moment in your life? For me, the most embarrassing moment happened several months after I met Siew Ling. That time she was not my wife yet, so we actually met together. We met when we were on staff with Crew Singapore, going through our first year as a new staff, going through the training. If you were on Singapore SMRT bus number 51, on the 21st of August, 1991, about 5 p.m., traveling along Pasir Panjang Road, you will probably witness this incident. Both of us, our hands were full with our files, our handbag, and many stuff. So after we boarded this bus, 51, a double-deck bus, we tried to go all the way to the back of the bus to get a seat. But it's a challenging task. Why? Because the bus tends to jerk. So when you were moving and the bus jerked, you lose your balance and that will be disastrous. And that was what happened to Siew Ling. The bus jerked when she tried to move and she fell flat onto the floorboard. What do you do next as a gentleman? Wow, it's time to be a hero. So, but the hero also in the predicament. My hands were also filled with stuff, trying to hold on to one railing. I tried to use the other hand to reach out to her, but I couldn't. It was too far away. So what do you need to do? I need to let go of this hand so that I can move to grab her. The moment I let go of this hand, the bus jerked, and I fell also on her. Therefore, marks the beginning of how we fell for each other, and now she's my wife. The passage that will rest to us, thank you, Brother Michael, for reading to us. As we read this passage, and even as you come to church this morning, how is the condition of your heart? How is your spiritual eyes? Did you come into the church hall this morning? Your spiritual eyes is like these dark glasses. If that is so, we will not able to see what Jesus is going to teach us, what he saw. Perhaps there are unconfessed sins in your life this morning. I would like us to take some time, even as I go to God in prayer. Because when we look at this passage, if we want to able to see as what Jesus saw, we need to come with a heart that is right before him. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Let's pray as I give ourselves some time to confess our sins. Dear God, we thank you. Thank you, God, that you are God who forgives all our sins. And Lord, we want to come to you, even with your help of the Holy Spirit, to help us to be able to see what Jesus saw. We ask, O God, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable to you. In Jesus' name, amen. We want to revisit this scene in Matthew chapter 9 that was read to us. As we have prayed, because God helping us to remove our preconceived spiritual lenses, understanding of this verse, that we were able to see what Jesus saw. What he saw moved him to feel compassion for the people. What he saw moved him to sound out the missionary call, the clarion call, to ready workers for the harvest field, and also the call, the reason for his incarnation, and the call that led him to the cruel cross. Jesus used the metaphor of herding to illustrate what he saw. What did Jesus see? He saw sheep without a shepherd. Timothy Leniak, an Old Testament professor, in his book, Shepherds After My Own Heart, he uses a wide range of texts in both the Old Testament and New Testament to develop a biblical theology of pastoral leadership using the shepherd imagery. He said this, The shepherd image is about perspective as much as practice. These are the kinds of effects and effects a metaphor should have. This month is the mission month for AMC. If we bounce our feet too quickly in responding to the missionary call, we may miss out something very important that anchors this call of God. But when we are able to grasp the purpose of the herding metaphor, we were able to appreciate and feel Jesus' heartbeat, and then we're able to respond accordingly to the missionary call. Jesus' herding metaphor describes that the people are like sheep without a shepherd. My brothers and sisters, what happened to sheep without a shepherd? They were harassed and helpless. The NASB uses the words, they were distressed and dispirited. Harassed, helpless, distressed, dispirited. What kind of adjectives are these? These adjectives carry intense descriptions of the dire condition of a sheep without a shepherd. What did Jesus see about these people who were being described in such oppressive manner? He saw three things that disturbed him and moved him to compassion. First, social. Second, physical. And third, spiritual. We want to look at first, social. Under social, Jesus saw the human slavery and the political situation in those days. One common sin when we, for Singaporeans, when we go overseas for holiday, that we look like chirping birds. Because things are getting more and more expensive here in Singapore. So when we go overseas, when we see things that are cheap, we say, wow, cheap. Wow, this one very cheap. Wow, that one luggy cheap. When Jesus walked the street of Nazareth in the Roman Empire, there was one thing that God knew and Jesus saw that was cheap. Up to 40% of the population in the empire were slaves. That means one out of every three persons was a slave. About 5 million people. Human life was cheap. Men, women, and even children were bought and sold in the slave market along the streets every day. To a slave, redemption was not just a mere word. It was a longing desire, for it meant deliverance and freedom from slavery. We will not be able to understand this longing to be redeemed because Singapore has no slavery. The most we can feel is for the foreign domestic ladies who miss their children back home when they come here to work. But for Jesus, he saw the cruel society on these helpless slaves. He felt for them. The other part about social that Jesus saw was the political situation. The Jews were dismayed by the political state of Israel. Because why? For the last 500 years, they were under different empire. When they were in exile, they were under the Babylonian Empire, King Nebuchadnezzar. When they came back, they were under the Greek Empire, King Alexander the Great. Then after that, in the Roman Empire, King Herod the Great, when would be the king of the Jews, the king of Israel? So when they saw Jesus perform so many miracles, our king has come. So they expected, they thought that Jesus is going to lead a political rebellion against the Roman Empire to fight for them. We are really blessed to have a politically stable, geographically safe, and economically strong state of Singapore. But we can hear and know of devastated countries not far away from Singapore. Timor-Leste is a poor country. And we go further away, we know about Syria. Syria has a population of 21 million people. But out of this 21 million, 13.5 million become refugees. They have to flee the country to go neighboring countries because of war. And places where people do not have enough job to feed their children. And some countries, because of corrupted and tyrant leaders like North Korea, or countries that are hit by natural disasters such as Philippines, which yearly typhoon. And a few years ago, the seasonal flood, and right now it hit America these few days. But a few years ago, it hit Nepal, Bangladesh, India, killed 500 people, 60 million people were displaced, resulting in further food shortages and diseases. My brothers and sisters, most of you are young. Our younger Singaporeans need to know and understand the significance of this Chinese expression, Guo Tai Ming An. It means peace and prosperity for the nation. For the older Singaporeans like me, some of us might be unhappy with some of the things that's happening in Singapore, but we need to be thankful, my brothers and sisters, that God has blessed Singapore with peace and prosperity, unlike many nations that I have mentioned earlier. For Jesus, he felt for God's chosen people, the Jews, under that social situation. The second aspect that Jesus saw is the struggle of the people as they faced physical illnesses, sicknesses, and death. There were numerous accounts of Jesus' healing miracles before and after this passage in Matthew 9. But I want to highlight one aspect of it. I want to ask us this question. What can be the worst thing that can happen to any human or can happen to you? Death. Death. We agree that physical death can be scary, especially for those of us, our loved ones, who do not know Christ, as they have to reckon what happens after death. But our faith in Jesus dispels all fear, as Christ's substitutionary death on the cross paid the penalty for all our sins. We are being snatched from the darkness of hell and brought into the marvelous kingdom of light. Don't take that for granted, my brothers and sisters. The New Testament records for us how Jesus raised 3 persons from their death to a life. The 3 persons, the widows of Nain's sons in Luke chapter 7, Jairus' daughter in Luke 8, and Lazarus in John 11. The phrase moved with compassion and was read to us in Matthew 9:35-38, Jesus moved with compassion. This phrase moved with compassion also appears in Luke 7:13 in Nain's sons, and also Matthew 9:36, the Jairus' daughter. The Greek meaning for move with compassion is actually to move in the bowels. Where is your bowels? The bowels, that means to move in the inward parts of the body, such as the heart, the lungs, the liver, and the kidneys. The bowels were thought to be the seat of love and pity. So when he said he saw and he was moved with compassion, that was the totality of his whole human body that was moved with compassion. In Lazarus' case, this phrase was not used, but the shortest Bible appeared in that passage, in John 11. Jesus wept. Jesus wept, my brothers and sisters. The Son of God wept. Wept for what? Wept for when he saw how the people struggle with physical death. I have never felt how the death of a loved one was like until it happened to my mom, even though at that time I was already 25 years old. Being the youngest in the family, five sisters and one brother ahead of me, I felt so much for my mom when I looked at her distraught state with all the post-surgical tubes around her after the removal of a cancerous womb. I was determined to share the gospel when she recuperated. And true enough, a few days later, in her recuperation, I took the courage to share the four spiritual law, the gospel, to her. God prepared her heart. I led my own mom to Christ with a sinner's prayer. Despite the fact that she was near illiteracy, her hunger and thirst to grow in God was amazing. God honored her faith and surprised the doctors that she recovered and lived for several more good years. But the cancer cells survived. And later on, the doctor was right. Her days on earth were numbered. But her faith in God remained unwavered. In view of her immobility, her baptism service was conducted at home. She testified of God's goodness and urged her husband and her children to believe in the Lord. The Lord took her home eventually in April 1991. 1 week after her passing, I started my first day in serving God as a Christian worker with Cruise Singapore. But you know what, my brothers and sisters, my heart struggled with intense emotion 1 year before she died and when she died. Because she was so sick, but I felt God's prompting to step into Christian work, but I was not too sure about the timing. When she passed on, I thought that I've got over the death, especially during the wake. Because during the wake, it's a time for you to grieve and mourn. Even though I do not mourn like the non-Christian, but she is my own mother. So I thought that I have able to mourn, to grieve enough. Even though at that time I was busily looking into every detail of the wake, being the other Christians, only other Christians. It was not until 2 years late, 2 years ago, in June 2015, that when my wife and I attended a week of intensive consultative coaching for personal development, I realized that I did not grieve as much as I needed as a youngest child during that busy week. My soul was still hurting. Near the end of that 1 week, during one sharing, I found myself crying profusely away for an event that happened so many years ago. Brothers and sisters, even though I did not know the full extent of how my mom's death had affected me, I learned something very precious. Jesus knows. And I was thankful that God, through that coaching, has helped my hurting soul to go back all the way to that wake 24 years ago for the youngest to really grieve for the loss of my mom. Jesus saw, Jesus felt, and Jesus moved with compassion. Each time when Jesus heals the sick or raises the dead, the gospel writer described to us that the healing often include the spiritual, not just the physical. And this brings us to the third aspect that Jesus saw. He saw the spiritual condition that the people were under slavery to sin and Satan. Jesus saw the people whom God, in the triune God, has created in his image for his own. Once freed from sin and Satan, the image has been marred. And right now, because of the fall, the people today are slaves to sin and Satan. When Matthew pens down this verse, seeing the people, he has helped us to appreciate what God has been seeing, what God has been feeling since the fall of man. What did Jesus see about the oppression of sin and Satan upon his own creation that grieves his heart and moves him to compassion? In order for us to know that, we need to know a bit of this Greek word called agorazo. Agorazo is one interesting Greek word for redemption. It's found in 1 Corinthians 6:20. It is from the root word agora, agora meaning market. Agorazo means to buy in the market. And agora is where we get our English word agriculture. In the ancient Greek economy, 80% of the population were farmers. But the word agora, market, is not used here for agriculture market for animals and vegetables. It is a different market. Fallen men in the slave market under the control of sin and Satan. So the word agorazo, to buy in the market, it emphasized in the market, it emphasized the terrible place from where we were redeemed, the slave market of sin and Satan. And this was what Jesus saw. This was what Jesus saw. The situations in many unreached places in the world. Unreached people, unreached nations. The slave market of sin and Satan. It was a spiritual condition of Japan that God called my family to serve him in 1998 when the eldest son was only 2 years old. Though Japan is an affluent nation, the Japanese people face great moral decadence and spiritual darkness. On the eve of a prayer and fast marathon, God led me to Ezekiel 22:30, which talks about God looking for man to stand in the gap to pray for Israel to repent from her sins. But he found none. That was so sad. So I felt the Lord's prompting that I should not neglect to pray for the spiritual condition of Japan during that 40 days. The following morning, while meditating on Ezekiel 23, the term youth prostitution in verse 3, which describes Israel's spiritual adultery against God, caught my attention. This term, youth prostitution, so very accurately portrays one of Japan's biggest social problems. Youth prostitution. Both the Japanese national newspaper and the local Straits Times then, they reported that Japanese teenagers are selling their bodies to businessmen in exchange for cash in pursuit for materialism. And second thing about the Japanese condition, the spiritual condition, that they're really blinded with deep spiritual darkness. When our MRT in Singapore break down, we will complain because, I'm going to be late for this and that. And the breakdown is largely due to technical problem. But in Japan, rail train system, the announcement that came to the carriages that the breakdown was due to the delay of human incidents. Every year, about 30,000 Japanese would jump onto the tracks to let the fast train whiz by and take their lives away. The population of Christians in Japan was less than 1% then. Though it is a wealthy country, it is in great spiritual apathy. Figuratively speaking, it is a nation that does not fear God. And it is scary to read in the Old Testament how God punished such nations. Near the end of the fasting discipline, God gave us the faith to respond to his call. Though there were many giants, such as our still very weak faith, the amount of support that we need to raise, the pain of saying goodbye to our loved ones, and the fear of stepping into the unknown with a young child. We stayed there 6 years. We were so thankful that we responded to the call of mission. For the 6 years, as the Lord used us to reach out to Japanese university students and homemakers, and even after we returned in 1998, we were so thankful that 3 of the students, they are now ministering as pastors in the local churches there. Brothers and sisters, when we are able to see what Jesus saw, participation in mission will become an inevitable outcome. The church and the people around us will be amazed what will happen next. One of the commentators said this, our mission means our committed participation as God's people at God's invitation and command in God's own mission within the history of God's world for the redemption of God's creation. I've included in the notes some suggestions on how you can be able to be involved in missions. What did Jesus see? He saw the three things. First, the social aspect, the human slavery and the political constraint of the Jews. Second, he saw the hopelessness of the people as they faced physical sicknesses and death. Third, and the most important of all, he saw the people in the slave market of sin, oppressed by Satan. My brothers and sisters, this was what Jesus saw. The intense, wretched condition of men. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were helpless, harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Primarily, the meaning of Greek word for harassed is to flay. There was a time when the Greek uses this word to compare his trouble to the pains of being flayed alive. What is flaying alive means? Being flayed alive is one terrible punishment used in the ancient days and also by the Romans. It was a method of slow and painful execution in which the skin is removed from the body. An attempt is generally made to keep the removed portion of the skin intact. The possible causes of death were shock, critical loss of blood, body fluids, hypothermia, infections, and the death is expected to last to occur up a few hours or up to a few days after the flaying. And it's just interesting that the King James Version uses the word they fainted. So this was the condition that what Jesus saw. He saw that these people, they were in trouble, like being flayed alive. The social, the physical, and the spiritual. Another commentator said this: what causes Jesus' compassion at this point is not the abundance of sicknesses he has seen, but rather the great spiritual need of the people, whose life has no center, whose existence seems aimless, whose experience is one of futility. The whole gospel is a response to just this universal human need. My brothers and sisters, this was what Jesus saw. Can we see that? Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, for this church. Lord, we thank you, God, for the leaders of this church, for Pastor Ku, Pastor Ho, and also for all the LCEC's committee members. We ask, oh God, for your blessing on these leaders. That God, we know that they have their own family, their own situation, their challenges in life. That God, you encourage these servants that serve you faithfully. With whatever challenges that they face in their life, God, that you will bless these leaders of this church, these shepherds of this church. Father, we also want to take this time to pray and respond to your word this morning. That God, thank you, God, for the Holy Spirit to help us to be able to see what Jesus saw. The Lord, that you have spoken to us, some brothers and sisters, that you have spoken to us individually. So what should we do next in response to what we saw as Jesus saw? That God, when there's lack of faith, you grant them faith. When there's lack of courage, you grant them courage. When there's lack of wisdom, you grant all of us wisdom to be able to apply, to respond to your word. That we will not just be hearers of your word, Lord, but be doers of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.